I think I'll see the border open again. I don't think that I will see it open in my lifetime like it was before 9/11.
Beautiful, perfectly good bridge. But it's closed. This is what it looks like on one side of the river. This is what it looks like on the other. It looks a lot alike on both sides. That's because it is a lot alike. Same sky, the same land, joined at the river. This is the story about how the people here were separated. It's in Texas. They call it the Big Bend. And what bends is the river? The Rio Grande. Or as they say on the south side, the Rio Bravo. Well, it's quite a river. Small communities dot the river here. Because it's a desert, it's one of the few places people can live. Farther north, ranching towns like Marathon, Marfa, and Alpine crown the bend. There's not a lot of people around here. In some places in the bend, well, you get the idea. The heart of the bend is its river. The bend is shaped by the river, its name for the river, and the history of the bend is the history of what happens at the river. They crossed it freely, always have.
It's not like they were going over there forever or the Mexicans were coming over here forever. These people have come across this river here to work at Lajitas and some of the other places and then go back on a daily basis, just like at Redford and La Linda down there at the Black Gap on the other side of Big Bend National Park. It goes back to the time of the Paleo Indians. This crossing here at Lajitas, there's evidence here and at Redford and many of the other places, archaeological evidence goes back 10,000 years for people cross back and forth. It wasn't a border, it was a body of water.
So just to give you an example of my own family history, this is a land grant that was given to my great-grandfather from the state of Texas of 160 acres after homesteading here for 6 years. This is dated May 3rd, 1876, signed by the first Democratic governor in Texas after the war between the states. With this land grant came American citizenship. They cleared the lands, they built canals, they built the dams, they built their homes, they brought their families. This is a picture of my great-grandparents, Secundina Lujan. So this border, not only was it our land before it was a border, it's a land afterward. They helped build this land, so it's our land. It's our responsibility to protect it and to cherish it and to direct its future. And the border is arbitrary line on a piece of paper and in the mind of politicians. But in the life of the people, it's just a little river, you know, in the middle of nowhere, and where we've lived for many thousands of years.
People have lived here a long, long time. People have left their paintings, their carvings, their dwellings. In some places in the Bend, the landscape is honeycombed with natural shelters, perfect for people to live in. This is a grinding hole for making flour. And let's not forget the arrowheads. Who were these people and where'd they go?
This is human occupation here in our home. Possibly 10 to 12,000 years ago, we believe that human beings first reached the Big Bend, and we're still here. I can show you a genetic study that was done on the people of Ojinaga. This is where we get our girlfriends and our sisters get their boyfriends and my grandmothers, and you know, they all come from there because it's the biggest city in the Big Bend. This is an article from the American Journal of Human Genetics, volume 66 from the year 2000. On the mitochondrial DNA of the peoples of North Central Mexico. And mitochondrial DNA is the DNA passed on to the offspring by our mothers. And those people, this was a DNA study of the people of Juarez and Ojinaga. And the DNA, mitochondrial DNA frequencies of the people of Ojinaga in the year 2000 indicate that 5% of our mothers and grandmothers and great-grandmothers were African women. 3% of our mothers and grandmothers were European women. And 91% of our mothers and grandmothers and great-grandmothers were and are Native American women today. So the Indians haven't disappeared, we're still here. We may not shoot arrows and wear eagle feather headdresses, but we're still here. And we've been here for a long time, and we'll be here for another long time.
At the southern tip of the Bend is Big Bend National Park, among the most striking and sublime places in all the world.
At the visitor center, we would give out maps of the communities. We would mention where the restaurants were. We wouldn't recommend, but here's a map of Santa Elena, and there's four restaurants, and we'd circle them. We'd encourage people to go across. Not just to go across and have a meal and add to the economy, but also to take the boat ride, get their feet wet, walk up to the little communities or ride a burro to Boquillas. That is part of understanding the uniqueness not only of Big Bend National Park, but this region. And that the river is just that. It's a river. You get up to Illinois, you say the Rio Grande is an international boundary. Certainly it is. But down here, a lot of people view it just, it's a river. It's a small impediment. We go back and forth.
It wasn't a border to us and the people that were there, because, I mean, it was just an everyday experience going back and forth. I mean, it wasn't anything, they've been doing it for so long.
I mean, even though it's Mexico, it's still, in a sense, to me, Big Bend area over there. I mean, it's because it's just a river in between. You get a chance to just explore more of Big Bend, and if nothing else, you can see how people, you know, survive in that area.
That border is, you know, it's just been an arbitrary division. It was life in the middle of the desert.
I've been in and out of this area since I was 17 years old. I was one of the first three guides on this river back in the mid-60s.
Did you go to Mexico a lot?
Yes, sir. Go over there in recent years, I used to go over there a couple of times a month and have a meal, have a beer, maybe buy something at their little store. It's always been an interesting place to go. We've had people that used to go over there and play ball with the Mexicans on a Sunday afternoon, and if they didn't have enough players, then maybe we'd fill in with some Texans, and if the Texans didn't bring enough people to play ball, some Mexicans would play on the Texas team. It was great fun. Part of coming to the Big Bend was always to this area for the regular visitors was to come across here for a couple hours and have a meal and a beer and then go back, take some pictures there, visit with some of the people that became their friends.
Playing golf down in Lajitas with some friends, and several of us, it was our first trip over right then, and we just went down to, waved over to the boatman, he came over and picked us up and took us over, and we went over and ate our lunch in Paso Lajitas. And so from there I was hooked. Really, we're just eating in the woman's kitchen, and you had to call ahead of time and tell her what you wanted to eat, and everybody had to eat the same thing basically, so she'd cook a big pot. I was sitting there in shorts and flip-flops, and he brought these spirited Mexican horses around, and I get up on this thing, and the thing's not hardly moving, so I kick it a couple times, and bam, boy, we're going down the dusty roads of Santa Elena there. And people are, you know, Mexican culture, it's an outside culture. These people are all outside. And here I've got this runaway horse that's just, you know, I can't stop it. You know, it's going full blast. And it runs right at these people out in their yard. There's a fence there. And it just runs up and it stops. It literally tries to throw me off. And I was able to hang on. And after that, I guess I was, machismo enough to, you know, where the horse, you know, was kind of mine. And you know, I came trotting back up to the folks, and they were all kind of grinning, had a look on their face, and I said, "Ay caramba!" And that broke everybody into a big laugh. So, all my family and friends, every time they came, I'd take them across, say, "You've got to experience this cultural scene down here, because you nowhere else you'd be able to sit here and you know, take this rowboat across and just experience the ambiance of this wonderful Mexican food, cold beer, and you know, be looking across the river at the United States."
The border here is a river. It's a blending of culture, a blending of people, a blending of families. For years and years and years, for generations, it's a river with little footbridges across to places like Candelaria, where people go across and they shop, or they go back and forth on footbridges without to any threat, without any hesitation.
For many people in the Bend, crossing is a kind of Aboriginal right. At Lajitas, the crossing links the tiny town to the even smaller Paso Lajitas. The metal marker traces the use of the traditional crossing from Spanish conquistadores to 20th century bootleggers, bandits, and businessmen. The bright new inscription concludes, "Today the historic crossing connects two nations and cultures and is used by tourists and travelers from around the world." At this crossing, the United States government took violent direct action.
Go ahead and sit down.
All right.
Hold on.
I'll take
going back to talking about Black Friday, when there was folks that were trying to take pictures of the goings-on, the raid, the sting, whatever you want to call it, those cameras were taken away from them. They said they didn't arrest any minors, and that's not true. They may not have booked them, but they certainly put them in the van and left them in the parking lot with them. Took them somewhere. I know they got one young boy because his mother was in here just wailing and carrying on, and that's my baby, he's 12 years old. And this is all, of course, in Spanish, but between my understanding of Spanish and a very good interpreter that was trying to calm her down, a bilingual lady, we knew exactly what the problem was. And I know that the boy was in that van as it was driving off because she was hanging on to the door handle, chasing the van, screaming, and they were having to pull her off of the van. And they had planned, and I think they had some surveillance. They had enough vehicles to haul off a lot more people than they actually arrested. They claimed to have arrested somewhere around 24 people. they found some people. They arrested a guy that was getting gas, in line getting gas. I'm going, I'm so intimidated. I'm not running out there saying, can I get my 20 bucks before you arrest him? And they came in this store, took people out of line that were trying to get their checks cashed and get home. They came in and took them out, drug them out of the store. They had some people on a list that they were looking for. Whether or not they found all of them, I don't know. But they had some specific, they were information of people they were looking for, and then some they were just asking anybody and everybody for their papers. And they were just about anybody that started driving down the hill to get here were stopped even outside, brought out of their vehicles and made to prove who they were and what they were. Picked up some people under mistaken identity, said, oh, you're so-and-so, and they're saying, no, I'm not. Well, yes, you are. Well, no, I'm not. Well, prove it. Well, the burden of proof was on them to prove they weren't who they said they were, and so they were arrested until they could prove who they were, and then later released. One of the most interesting stories that afternoon was a German couple. They were in here, and they were old enough to have some memories of just this kind of behavior, and they were freaked. They said they had been traveling comfortably through the United States and had gotten out of the habit of carrying their passport, and that their passport was up in a hotel room with their stuff, and what should they do? And I said, you're white, shut your mouth, but you do have a pretty strong accent, it's pretty obvious you're not American, but keep your mouth shut, get in your vehicle, and drive away.
I couldn't believe it.
My reaction was one of intense rage.
Damn it. Damn it.
Like one of those idiotic bureaucratic decisions.
How stupid is this?
What's the point?
When I heard about it, I thought, what are the people in Boquias and Santa even going to do?
The tactics that they used, when they came in to close the border down, they didn't give any warning to the little boatman over here and said, don't bring your boat over, no more chalupa. You know, they didn't do that. They came in a van, marked Green River Tours, which highly offended me. They came out of that van with their guns drawn like Gestapos. They rounded up everybody down at the trading post that were cashing their paychecks from Lajitas, and they took them off to jail. And not only that, they went down to the river to the crossing where the little rowboat man used to be, motioned for him to come across. He came across, and the only thing he did was hold the boat. That's it. They arrested him. He was trespassing on American soil, and he was from a foreign country.
It's true. Two undercover agents with Border Patrol. There was the guy with the little chalupa, the little boat, and they motioned him over. And when he got there, they arrested him for illegally taking people out, and they confiscated the boat, and they arrested him, 16-year-old kid. He was third generation being a boatman. His dad and his granddad before him had been the boatman. And on the report, that old leaky rowboat was described as an aquatic invasion craft. So we see some ironies.
That young man, he's got a father who's in a wheelchair and a mother who's not very well either. His money that he made rowing that boat across the river was what supported his family. So what'd they do while he was in jail? Because he was there over a month. And then after they got him out of jail, he was in the deportation process. And they took him all the way to El Paso. And it took another month to get him out of that.
Part of the experience of coming to Big Bend for visitors is the ability to go across. And the border is a fragile area. And by closing the border, years, decades of work to build goodwill evaporated, was destroyed overnight. And it's going to be hard to regain. Those little villages are suffering. You know, the history of the border is one of conflict going back to the 1900s and before, but especially during the 1914-1920 period. You know, it was not a pretty place, not a safe place. And a lot of hard feelings developed on both sides. Those hard feelings have been people have worked hard to alleviate those hard feelings. And now with the closure and families being split, it's difficult. We work in the visitor center here at Big Bend National Park, as I mentioned, and we have people come in from Fort Stockton, from Midland, Odessa. Where are you going? We're going down to Boquias or Santa Elena, going to cross and see part of our family, see our grandmother, see our aunts. And now that they can't do it. They'd come down on a Sunday to go across, visit. By closing those crossings, they have split families. Not good.
For most of the 10 years that I served down here in an active capacity working for the church, it also, there was never any problem in crossing. And I would cross, I did a lot. I held masses on the other side as well as various places on this side. I went frequently right across the river to Palomas. One day, they told the lady who owned the boat that ran back and forth across the crossing that she couldn't do it anymore. And that was that. Things just gradually grew worse.
Do you know any families who have been separated by this?
Well, just about everybody in town.
What does that do to their families?
I guess it means that even if they can see each other's houses, they're as far apart as if one lived here and the other lived in Marfa, let's say.
How far away is Marfa?
Marfa's 75 miles from here.
And how far away are these houses that they can see?
A mile.
One of the most popular places in Big Bend National Park are the hot springs. People from all over the world gather at these springs. And just across the river, there are people, too. He sits across from the tourists, across from the wealth and the leisure, selling walking sticks and local art. But if the tourists swim across and pay him $10 for a walking stick, or hand him a $5 bill, when they swim back, that's a federal crime. Few communities in the Bend have been hit as hard by the border closing as Boquillas.
There was the Falcons where you'd go out and you'd sit, but then there was this little kind of like bar canteen that you'd go in, and it just, I mean, it reminded me of something out of the Old West, just the image in your head of a movie. He's just kind of scrubbing down the counter and all these dudes just sitting around, you know, having a beer, talking, or, you know, shooting the shit or whatever. And so you just kind of hang out and you can walk in there, and it was just like a fun little atmosphere. I mean, the whole thing just, I mean, it seriously was almost like a leftover prop from some kind of, you know, spaghetti Western film.
What can you be dangerous of? There ain't nobody here. It's just a waste of, you know, money that the U.S. is putting into it, because who in the world wants to come to Boquillas? Mm-hmm. Especially terrorists and stuff like that, you know. They're crazy. See all these people, they used to go across to the store and buy their gasoline, their meat, propane, everything, see? And then the tourists come over here and help support the family, see? People that got 5, 6 kids, 7 kids. Well, everybody loses. But I don't know, what money-wise or what?
Sure. Tell us about what people have lost over here since they closed the border.
Well, the kids, you know, they used to sell bracelets. You remember that. And they also sell their walking sticks and their little scorpions, you know, made out of brass wire or copper. And, you know, the people that got horses and burros, they used to bring the people to town, charge them $2-3, round trip. And the boatman has this $2 per person. And the bar, you know. And the restaurants, that's under tacos or burritos or whatever. You know, you just miss the people. You're used to hearing people talk, you know, and they used to bring their guitars and their violins and whatever, you know, and play here all day and night and have a good time. And a lot of tourists been complaining, see, to their congressmen and stuff like that. I had a whole bunch of letters, you know, that they put like in Dallas newspapers or Pennsylvania newspapers or from everywhere. You know, just a bunch of complaints.
You think you can get the border open again?
I don't know. I ain't got no idea.
What did you think? How did you feel?
Muy triste. Everybody, the people, this everybody, this is muy triste.
How much business did you lose?
¿Cuántos trabajos perdí?
¿Cuántos trabajos perdí? Mayo, junio, julio, agosto, septiembre, octubre, en noviembre, diciembre, el marzo, abril, y marzo discame el people, no people. Necesitamos que alguien nos ayude para que chance que abran la pasada, que dejen pasar turistas para acá, pero no.
Would you like them to open the border?
Yeah. Si quiere que abran el paso.
Sí, por mí sí. Yo quiero mucho que abran la pasada porque nosotros necesitamos. Ella es mi nieta y ella está estudiando. Y su mamá, nosotros tenemos todo aquí cerrado. Nosotros vinimos apenas el sábado. Sábado aquí por limpiar la casa y muy triste para nosotros.
What do you think about the border closing?
Oh, that it's bad for the people that live here.
How bad? What does it do?
They live off the tourists.
The tourists are gone. How do they live now?
Caliente, amigo.
Other people leave. See, how many do? How many left?
Like half.
You know, 70 to 80% of the population just leaves these towns because there's nothing else left to do. It's a pretty sad situation. It's really sad.
The people that stay have to make a living. And they may make a living in ways that we would prefer that they don't. Marijuana, I believe, if it hasn't increased, will increase. People will make a living. So I don't think it's in the best interest in the long run to have families that are stable and good and want to till the soil over in these communities and want to provide services for tourists to Big Bend to leave because you don't know what's going to come in.
Statistically, there is some increase in drug smuggling.
Have you seen an increase in the crime rate? Has the crime rate gone up? How has the crime rate changed? It's gone up, hasn't it? How has the crime rate changed? Have you seen a change in crime since the closings?
The percent increase, at least in one given snapshot in time, was from 1 to 13 or 1,300%.
What if you had a child and you lived in Mexico? Would you let your kid go hungry? Or would you do anything it took to make sure that that child had food in their belly when they go to sleep at night? I mean, I'm a mother.
You know, if you have a plant that's healthy, there are no parasites. It's the leaves are green and it looks healthy. It's in great shape. As soon as you stress that plant, the parasites move in. The towns on the other side of the river were joined with us, and we were a plant that was very healthy. The men had great power and strength because they worked and were able to support their families, and they bought their stuff here with us. And lived in Mexico. They weren't illegal. They had paperwork. But as soon as you cut that line and separate them, you stressed half the plant. And so the parasites moved in. Those parasites are what make this area dangerous now.
The simple fact is that everyone who has lived here has an interest in having the border open. Stopping terrorists is part of that. But when it is closed, that imperative is lost. Bad people come in. Bad things can happen, like never before. Living on this desert border isn't easy. It takes a lot of work to live here. There's very little to go on. It's so much harder when half the people, half the land, and half the world here are declared off limits. The people who live here say they need each other, say they need to be joined, not separated.
As an anthropologist, I have a love of the culture on both sides of the river. And before the closings, that culture those both of those cultures intertwined, you know, we were meshed. And I mean, you know, the people that worked over here and back and forth and one thing or another, but there was like a camaraderie ship. You know, the people in the remote areas, you have to come together. You can look at it back through history and all the neighbors, they'd come over for the barn raising or these kind of things. And it was the same thing that right there along the border. There was a back and forth, a helping hand extending across the border. And that hand is no longer there across the border. And I find it to be a travesty. You know, it just has affected the cultures on both sides of the border. And it's just a shame.
This is a small community. Those people just lived on the other side of the river. They depended on us. We depended on them for a lot of things. We had a symbiotic relationship.
I love this country. I like the freedom that I have here without the city codes, restrictions, and all the rest of it. I like being on my solar and off the grid. And I've got just enough to get by with. This over here is the solar system I'm on. There's 400 watts. They're about $500 a panel right now for that size panel. Here's a collar and a lathe right now that'll fix the bore out. And this all runs off of DC. This is run off 12 volts. Drill press runs off of 12 volts. Everything runs off 12 volts. On this, and this is a bicycle front, and it allows the wind generator to swivel in the wind. Here's brushes, and I've got copper rings on this in here, and the power goes down then, and it doesn't wind your wire up. But see, that's a bicycle, and I want to build a bigger wind generator so I went and got some motorcycles junk to do the same thing with.
You built a generator out of a bicycle?
Well, what they're doing along here is they're catching all our help that was coming over here and going back across the river. And they'd come over and work 10, 12 hours a day. And that's all they want to do is work for just a few days or a few hours and make some bean money, and they'd go on back home. And we didn't have much problems with it. We'd have problems sometimes with the horses and all coming over here. And once in a while, you'd catch a guy can go and pick up something out of the yard and go back with it, but not often. Because they kind of watched out for us here. They knew that there was money to be made over here, and they didn't mess with us too much. Well, the Border Patrol has picked up so many of them now and stuck them in jail for 6 months at a time. And they won't bring them back to Alpine. They turn them loose in El Paso, and they have to thumb their way home from El Paso. Victor got picked up at Tino's, and he's an older man. He's in his 50s, or no, he's in his 60s, actually, and he's, I think, still in Alpine right now, and he's been up there about 6 months, and they're making him cook at the jail, and they'll hold him as long as they can.
How long have you been taking care of the post office here?
Since 1987.
Thank you.
I've been doing that for almost 20 years.
You used to have a store here.
Yes, sir. And I started in 1991.
Why did you have to close down?
Well, there was no more business. They wouldn't let anybody across from Mexico. And that was the main thing.
When they used to come over, what kind of things did they buy from you?
Milk and flour, chicken, just for their families,
something
to eat.
Groceries.
Beans, and of course beer in summer, in summer too.
How did that change your life when you lost that business?
Well, I was fortunate that I had the little post office and I had apartments. But I was making on the clear about $10,000 a year on the store, on the little store profit, and that went down the drain right away.
Do you know other people who lost businesses who were hurt when they closed the crossings?
Sure, most of the farmers were also employing people from across. They'd come over and go back in the afternoon, and they wouldn't cross anymore. So. Well, you can see the farm right now, it's completely shattered, you know.
It's all weeds out there.
Nothing but weeds.
Do you know how this affected people across the river? What did it do to them?
Well, they migrated to Odessa and Midland, most of them. Just got some papers or have their family get them across legally so they could work over there. There's very little people living in Mexico now too, on the by the border.
Here?
Here.
Really? I didn't know that.
More than 50%, I think.
Really?
Left.
Wow.
People have always come back and forth here on a daily basis to work. It's just in the last 3 years that they haven't been able to do that, after 10,000.
No.
West of Presidio, we find the communities of Ruidosa and Candelaria. The farther out you go, the more isolated and surreal the border becomes. You enter the land of footbridges.
Thank you.
Candelaria. Beyond it, hundreds of miles of inaccessible desert border. The small farming community of San Antonio del Bravo lies across the creek that is the Rio Grande here. The steps are bent by the feet of the people who have always lived here, daily going back and forth, generation after generation. The sign threatens the villagers with severe criminal penalties. This is what it looks like on one side of the sign, and this is what it looks like on the other. The forceful closing the sign threatens is seen as a menace to the people's living and the well-being of their children.
Tell me about the border closings. What do you think?
I don't think it's good, but they want to do it. Well, what can we do? We've been going by here for 40 years. Maybe 100 years. But I've been going here 40 years. And I don't know. I don't think it's a good idea, but I don't know.
Nosotros aquí tenemos el dominio. No. Nunca, no ha habido terroristas aquí, nunca hemos habido. La migración ha estado aquí por mucho tiempo y nunca trampa a nadie.
Puede que pasen escondidos.
A lo mejor que pasan en avión por allá, en otra parte.
Aquí todo el tiempo ha sido un...
Pacífico, ni nunca han agarrado droga ni nada aquí, en este puente nunca. Y ahí lo han cuidado y queremos que nos lo sigan dejando ahí, por favor. Creo que tenemos un derecho.
Sí, alegra, alegre.
¿Y a mí también? ¿Y un besito? Ay, yo lo llevé. A rato viene.
Patadón.
Va a estar más grande que yo.
El sombrero está cayendo.
Sí.
Bueno,
que le va. Gracias.
Excelente. Excelente.
¿Qué?
Dale dos saludos a todos y dile también a la
Bueno. Damn, this thing's heavy.
Taran.
And I'm not taking nothing, I'm just, you know, clothes and the kid and the little dog, that's all I got. All them little kids, they gotta go to school and they gotta cross through there. I think they won't go to school no more.
They're humans like we are. Is that not true? They're humans like we are. They eat what we eat. They work like we work.
What happens to them if the border gets closed?
They lose a lot.
What do they lose?
working privileges, school, money, you know, how are they going to survive?
Do you think that there are terrorists over there?
No.
What do folks in Rio Doce think about the closure?
Well, we don't like it. It's cut down our business considerably because we used to have, there used to be about 50 people living over in Broncos. And they tore down our footbridge, but they left the one up at Candelaria. And they've torn a lot of the other bridges down. One right down here at our crossing. There was one down here about another mile and a half.
What happened to these bridges?
Border Patrol tore them down.
Physically destroyed them?
Yes. These people were not going anyplace but right here. I mean, they came over to get their mail right here.
When did you first encounter the Border Patrol trying to change?
After 9/11, 2001. I mean, they walked in my store and said, you know, those people over there are terrorists. And I said, really? I've spent over 70 years on this border, and they never terrorized me. I spent my time trying to make friends with the people over there and telling them that we would help them any way we could. If they needed extra groceries, we'd try to bring them from town and keep supplies here, you know, for our people. If they needed medication or something like that, and occasionally they still do come over. They wade the river and come over to call an ambulance when they need some help, and I let them use my telephone.
Is this your shop?
Yes, this is my store.
When they closed the border, and they said to you they were going to tear down the bridges. What did you think? How did you feel?
Well, you know, I was disappointed. Because these people over here are not... they're not terrorists. They're people. They're humans. And they need help just as much as anybody else. I don't know, like I say, I grew up here on the border, so I learned Spanish at the time I was learning English. My mother taught school in Trilingua. I had a Mexican babysitter that stayed with me, you know, my first, well, basically 6 years of my life, and I loved her dearly.
What happens to those kids if they don't get to go to school?
They grow up ignorant. Or uneducated. Illiterate. Not necessarily ignorant, because they do, you know, they do learn some things, and they learn survival skills. That's just about it. But they're illiterate. They can't read and write in any language. Have former students who come in here, they'll come down to see their parents, their grandparents. They nearly always stop by the store to check on me and see if I'm still here and how am I doing, you know. And it makes me feel good that they remember me and that they're even interested, you know, in how I'm doing.
Terlingua and Studi Butte have all kinds of neat little shops, galleries, and restaurants. I mean, there's everything here. We'll be right back. all these local homespun businesses? Well, these are the people they have to depend on. Touristas, the tourists.
Good film, Tom.
And if they're not happy, ain't nobody happy.
No, that'd be you and I. And
her. Whoops, sorry about that, babe.
I'm not the boss, and I don't do the books, but I can tell you it's easily 50% of our business was lost when they shut the border. 50%. Here's the head of the Border Patrol that's saying, basically, we've got the personnel and we've got the resources now, and his quote is, we're marching to the border. Marching to the border? I mean, as though we were some sort of enemy down here. And that was very upsetting for us that live here. We consider ourselves a community here. This thing called border is a glaring abstract. For us that live here, it's a community. It's got a little ditch of water between us, but we helped them, they helped us. Tourism is our only industry out here. And believe me, those little restaurants and cute little curio shops and stuff that were tic-tacked up and down the border, were, the tourists loved it. They loved to get in their little rowboat, go over there, have dinner, buy a blanket and come back and have had an experience in Mexico without all the trauma and the scariness of going into Mexico. And it was a big draw for tourism. And again, our only industry. The only way these guys had a way of making a living, and it's the only way we have a way of making a living. There's no Uniroyal factories out here. There's no shoe factories. Or, you know, we have to make a living off of tourism. And it has truly hurt our business. Not just the tourism, but the fact that these folks can't come over here and shop anymore. And this, the Lajitas Trading Post is the oldest continually operating mercantile west of the Mississippi. And for miles and miles on that side of the border, there is no store that can near match the availability and the prices that we offer these goods. We still carry horseshoe nails, we just don't sell as many.
Pam Ware's been telling this to every newspaper, every news channel, every film crew that will listen, and every congressman and politician too. Except the congressman won't listen. I think we know why.
They protect our freedom, saved our rights.
They protect our freedom, saved our rights.
When called to duty, they fought our fights.
When called to duty, they fought our fights.
As a shadow falls on the long black wall.
As a shadow falls on the long black wall.
Wipe your tear away, chin high, stand tall.
Wipe your tear away, chin high, stand tall.
Why are we here? What do we say?
Why are we here? What do we say?
Bless our vets, thank them every day.
Bless our vets, thank them every day.
Your left, your left,
your left, right, left.
Dismissed. 9/11 wasn't easy on anyone. People got scared. The government did a lot of scary things. In the Bend, the United States government committed itself to a military-style reaction to an ancient way of life. So to people here in the Big Bend, the noble cause of protecting Americans, of protecting themselves, is being twisted beyond recognition.
Well, one of the things the government says is that closing those crossings has happened to protect us from terrorists.
Our biggest terrorist is in Washington, D.C., and has been since I was a kid.
You know, to me, it's just a whole rehash of the Cold War, you know, teach the kids to kiss their ass underneath the school desk.
And it's like when we all hid under our desks in the 60s and practicing against that nuclear war. It wouldn't have done much good, but it made everybody feel better. And I think this is much the same thing.
And here we were looking at the skies for Soviet aircraft.
You told me that when you were a kid, they went door to door and gave you... What?
Yes, they gave us handbooks with silhouettes and photos of communist bloc military bombers and fighters. And they asked us to come outside at night, like we always do, and watch the skies for bombers coming in from Mexico to attack the United States in the 50s and early 60s.
Yeah, we used to have bombs in the schools. We'd go out in the halls and
A-bomb, atomic bomb drills.
Yeah, the kiss your ass goodbye
stuff. But here we were looking for Soviet transcontinental bombers flying over Mexico to bomb Austin from the south and Washington, D.C. And they were watching with a dew line in Canada from the north, over the North Pole. And if we saw a Soviet bomber or fighters, we were supposed to call a certain number and, you know, set off the alarm. I mean, that was a paranoia. That paranoia started with fear against the Indians, fear against the blacks, fear against the Mexicans, fear against the Huns, fear against the communists of the labor unions, fear against the Bosch and the Nazis and the communists in Korea and the Vietnamese and now it's the Al Qaeda terrorists. I think as a people we are so ruggedly individualistic in our mind that there is no way we can be a cohesive political nation unless we have a common enemy we're scared to death of. And when we run out of communists and terrorists, I guess it'll be aliens from outer space that will be scaring us to death, and we'll be out here looking for UFOs and making phone calls to Dallas.
Is there a terrorist threat? I don't think there is. I don't see it. I think we were better served by having friends in Mexico that would serve as a buffer and tell us. We had good relationships with them. The park had good relationships with them. Mr. Smith down at Lajitas, his people had good relationships with them. Those little communities serve as a buffer. But closing the crossings to those little communities doesn't alleviate a threat of terrorism.
If somebody weird showed up, would people...
We would know. We would know if somebody different was here or...
We'll hold him.
Yeah. I mean, everybody here knows each other. Everybody. There's not a person there that doesn't know each other. There's not a person here that doesn't know each other. They all know each other. They're all in somehow related.
Because they were our friends, some of them have relations here, they would have told us if there's anybody strange coming through. In fact, they even discouraged their own people from coming through this area, their own Mexican people.
When we notice anything that we consider the least bit of suspicious, I've got the Border Patrol's 800 number, and I don't have any qualms about calling them and telling them, look, there's a car coming up Pinto Canyon. You need to check him out. He just doesn't give me a good feeling. And they did, and they found out this man had about 10 different items of identification, 10 different IDs, and I don't know what all, but, you know, cut us a little bit of slack. I taught school for 39 and a half years. I know that rules are made, there's a reason for rules, but you can't expect every rule to apply to every child. rules are meant to be broken occasionally. I don't care whose rules they are. You just need to consider the situation, because some situations are isolated. And I feel like we are down here. We're isolated in more ways than one.
You know, I mean, we're so worried about, like, preventing another September 11th. I mean, that's always been the big slogan, you know, do you want another September 11th? And, I mean, they could have closed the border down for drug reasons or whatever, even before September 11th. And I imagine the bombing still would have happened because, I mean, we find out now by the terrorists, I mean, they flew in through our own checkpoints. They didn't sneak in through some illegal border. It wasn't some backdoor thing. They came in through our own things. They had passports and they had, you know, student visas or whatever. And I mean, they came over through our own checking system. So closing down an arbitrary border, you know, like Boquillas or, I mean, anywhere, as being this unsecured thing that we need to protect ourselves against, that's not where terrorists go. That's not, you know, that wouldn't have stopped anything.
Our stretch of the river is a totally different situation than, say, Tijuana and San Diego, or the Rio Grande Valley, or El Paso, or Douglas, Arizona. It's remote, it's tough country, terrorists aren't going to come across here.
People from the outside really don't understand out here, because this border is protected, always has been. You have 200 miles of desert.
That's Big Ben from space. Not a lot of green. Not a lot of green. Without an experienced local guide, could a foreign terrorist cross this desert? I don't know. They might get lucky. It might go like this. Beyond the river, water is rare and transient. And those places it is reliable are known to very few. And most of them aren't even human. The people who live here are convinced it would go more like this. Then there are the Border Patrol checkpoints.
There are border checkpoints on all the major roads. You guys playing hacky sack? Looks like it. How's it going? We're down from Gate 4. We stay with some friends. No, in Trilingua. Only the lonely. We've been doing some geology work, some collecting. Excuse me? Oh, no, I'm from Baker University. Lee Batcher. That's cool.
Both
United States
citizens?
Absolutely. Enjoy. Oh, whoa, whoa, something fast.
Whoa!
What are you doing filming the checkpoint? He said no.
What's happening?
Have you been drinking?
No, I've not been drinking. Have you, sir? I'm not drinking.
What about you?
No, sir.
He just finished telling you not to film the checkpoint. Why is he filming the checkpoint?
He made no mention of any filming. He asked me where I was from.
He doesn't film this side of the checkpoint.
Yeah, he was filming all the way around.
Oh, no, no, we're just right here.
It's coming on in.
Let me see. see what you have in there.
You want me to see what I've recorded?
Yeah.
Well.
And there's plenty of opportunity to catch anybody that that does fit that model. There's just very little chance that any group of foreign nationals are going to set up any kind of camp anywhere around here. These are remote areas, but there's a local population that sees and hears everything that happens. I don't buy that for a minute, that you could have any kind of group come in of foreign nationals that wouldn't, you know, really draw big time attention to themselves.
Truth is that the river can be crossed anywhere by even a small child. Not just at the community crossings, but anywhere.
We're all mate. Oh, it's freezing this river here.
In some places, the river is fast and very shallow. In other places, it's deep and a bit slower. Take your pick. You can either walk or swim. Hold it. Let's see that again. The river is less than 50 feet wide. If terrorists can playfully cross anywhere, what good is it to close the community crossings? What's the point? Naturally, people celebrate the futility of it all in word and deed.
I was going across at La Linda when they opened that up for a while, and then they closed it.
I've seen that bridge, and that there's a big barricade nowadays that faces Mexico, and it's built to keep people from coming from Mexico over. It's got a big canopy over it. You'd have to climb up and over. It just looks pretty formidable.
Well, there's a story going around about a guy that pulled a truck down there. But he pulled a truck down there and took some timbers and made a ramp on the back of his truck, and a couple of guys come across on their motorcycles, on their dirt bikes. They went up that ramp and sailed over the fence and landed on the other side on the bridge, and away they went. I don't know if there's any truth in that one or not.
But one thing is certainly true. At every crossing we visit, there are ample signs it is still being used. But by what kind of people?
They also talk about maybe putting surveillance in and maybe opening it at certain times for certain periods of time, certain days, but none of that has come about. And whether people are being stonewalled at the local level, the mid-level, or at the federal level, I don't know. I think it's a stonewall.
Why are they stonewalling you?
The decision, one, is an outgrowth of 9/11. It's an outgrowth of the Patriot Act. It's an outgrowth of being able to have a rich country that can throw money at a problem by hiring additional Border Patrol, giving him more equipment and more technology, and saying, let's close the border and make sure this doesn't happen. Whether this border is amenable to terrorist crossing or not, we've addressed that. Even if it's not, no one wants their head to roll by having a terrorist come through on their watch.
The anger over there. They say, why did your government do this? We've done nothing.
why? They don't understand. So how do you keep a community together when you've just slapped them in the face? And it's not us that slapped them in the face, it's our government that slapped them in the face. When the water was low, they'd drive the trucks across, they'd come over on this side, they'd go get their milk and go get their food and get gas for their vehicles and medicines and maybe go up to the doctor in Alpine, because they don't have a doctor over there. They don't have a pharmacopoeia over there, you know?
Over the decades, the park has helped people in the communities there get to doctors or get crossing papers through INS. The park at one time was an extension of INS, and we actually wrote crossing cards for people with a certain level of paperwork and helped them get medical care or other things through the paperwork process years ago. In recent times, that isn't the case, I don't believe, just simply because the border is closed, and that is a loss to those people.
And their store, if you've ever been in it, doesn't carry all that much. It doesn't have a lot of variety. So they would come over here to go shopping, and then they would go back home. And the kids would come across in the rowboat in the morning to go to school down at Terlingua.
Border's not going away. It's growing. But unless it's in your face, I just don't see people caring too much about what happens to them. Perhaps if you took them down there and showed them the beauty of a desert region, and showed them an evening on the Rio Grande, and then took away their wallet and their money, their medical supplies, electricity, and made them live in an adobe hut for 6 months, maybe then people would understand.
Think people have put any of this behind them? The people I've talked to have not put any of it behind them. Could have been yesterday or a year ago, and if nothing changes, 3 years down the line, it'll still be right with them.
All the things that I want for myself and my family, I have an obligation to see that they are the same things that you want for yourself and your family. One of the great political philosophers, Montesquieu, and he talks about liberty. The political liberty of the subject is a tranquility of mind arising from the opinion each person has of his safety. In order to have this liberty, it is requisite the government be so constituted as one man need not be afraid of another. If we are afraid of another, then we are not politically free. If we are afraid of our own government, then that is even worse. It is a worse betrayal and denial of political liberty. And we have seen it on the border, we live it on the border. And it is time for us to have a better world.
If they can afford to spend $32 million advertising a new $20 bill and how secure it is, I don't see why they can't put a customs station up here with some people to work it. And let these people get on with their life, and let these people come across the border and work and go back home at night, buy their groceries, get their gas, whatever they need to do. It's not hurting anybody.
There's a lot of print right now about the Canadian businesses along their border saying, wait, this is killing our business. You must loosen this. And they're talking about doing it. Well, now what's so special there? Why do they get a loosened border and we still have a grip here that is strangling the livelihood of miles and miles and miles of people? I mean, you have to understand that the only legal crossings are Del Rio, Acuna, and Presidio, Ojinaga. Now look at a map. It's hundreds of miles.
It has hurt both the Mexicans and the Americans economically because people can't cross on a short-term basis to do a little business and a little recreation. perhaps a roving customs officer just to keep things up on the up and up in the area between Redford and, say, La Linda, or even setting up a permanent little building here with a customs officer, and you just check in, come back and forth. Maybe we could get the workers that want to come across here on a daily basis, get them a day pass green card, you know, document them, and that way we will be fulfilling the law.
Is closing the bend crossings a bad idea? Folks who live in the bend say closing hurts everyone, accomplishes nothing. It even makes things more dangerous. Opening keeps them safer. But like any West Texan, they'll tell you, friend, you decide.
Current status of the historic river crossings here in Big Bend are that they are closed and have been since May of 2002, given homeland security concerns.
Makes it look like they're doing something when they're really not doing much at all. Gives the illusion that, you know, some action is being taken.
Ultimately, it's going to take American citizens' liberties away. Not, you know, it's not designed to make America a free country.
They're just making our homeland more safe. I don't suffer under this illusion.
I used to do horseback rides over there also. Half day with lunch. It was really nice.
You know what? I like to go eat enchiladas in Mexico. I like to go over there and visit. I like to give them my money. Because I am from there. And I know what it's like. So maybe if people would just sit and listen to all sides and then make a rational decision, I think that you could definitely improvise and come out with a much better solution.
We were having the best tacos in my life over there.